Hi everyone, it's Miss Marie, and this week for our Tales and Tales animal stories, we are going to be visiting the zoo. We're going to be reading wonderful stories about animals who live in the zoo and what it would be like to be a zookeeper. So join me as we read What Do You Do If You Work at the Zoo by Steve Jenkins and A Sick Day for Amos McGee by Philip Stead. Okay, so for our first book, for Tales and Tales at the Zoo, I would like to introduce you to this wonderful story. It's a new book actually called What Do You Do If You Work at the Zoo? It's sort of a combination of fiction and nonfiction. Mostly I'd say it's nonfiction. It's by one of my favorite authors, Steve Jenkins, and illustrated by Robin Page. And this is all about what it's like to work at a zoo. And it's published by Houghton Mifflin Harcourt. All right, what do you do if you work at the zoo? What do you think? What would you do if you worked at the zoo? What do you do if you work at the zoo? Well, you'll be a zookeeper, a person who takes care of the animals. You'll feed your animals, of course, and you'll do your best to make sure they stay healthy and safe. But zookeepers also have more unusual responsibilities. You might find yourself playing games with a monkey, imitating a vulture, weighing a snake, even tickling a tapir. Here are a few of the surprising things you might do if you decide to work at a zoo. You could cuddle a joey. That's what you call a baby kangaroo. A mother kangaroo keeps her baby, called a joey, safe in a pouch on her belly. This joey doesn't have a mother, so for the next 6 months, you'll carry it in your own pouch made of cloth. Over here, you could impersonate a vulture. This king vulture chick is being raised in a zoo. But when it is old enough to be, it will be released into the wild. To keep it from becoming attached to a human, you should feed it with a hand puppet that looks like an adult vulture. Oh my goodness, that's so silly. They put a hand puppet on that looks like a vulture to feed the baby. You could count a colony. It's important to keep track of all the animals in a zoo. Making a regular count of these Humboldt penguins will ensure that none of them are missing or sick. Very important. Those mastiffs, right? You could rub an aardvark's ears. At home in Africa, aardvarks are nighttime creatures, but in a zoo they are often active during the day, so you'll need to slather sunscreen onto the aardvark's sensitive ears to keep them from getting sunburned. Oh my goodness. You could shine a tortoise's shell. Polishing this Galapagos tortoise's shell keeps it from drying out and cracking, and the tortoise seems to enjoy the attention. You could puzzle a meerkat. Why hide a meerkat's snack? It's not always easy for a wild animal to find food. When you give this meerkat a puzzle, it must figure out which tube has a treat inside. You'll be encouraging its natural behavior, so it's like a little game for it. And then you have to warm it up. In Africa, meerkats like to bask in the sun. When it's cold outside, you can help them stay toasty by turning on an infrared heat lamp. I think that it likes being warm in the sun like that, the meerkat. You could serenade a seal. If you're a musician, try playing a tune for a seal. The music seems to calm them down. And there's somebody playing the saxophone for the seal. Or you could tickle a tapir. A wild tapir rubs its body against a tree to remove ticks and other parasites. In a zoo, it doesn't have to worry about parasites, but the tapir still likes a good rub, and it seems to enjoy the gentle scratching with a rake. It's too big to use something else. You gotta break. You could train a dragon. That's not a real dragon. It's a Komodo dragon. How do you get a dangerous giant lizard to climb into its cage so a vet can check it up? Give it a checkup. You train it to pursue a ball and a stick and to get a reward. When the Komodo dragon follows the ball into its cage, it'll have a rat to eat. What a treat, I guess, for the Komodo dragon. So it is a real dragon, but not a fire-breathing dragon, I guess I should say. It's real. You could bottle feed a giraffe or a manatee. This little giraffe's mother is sick and it can't nurse her baby, so you'll need to give the calf a bottle of milk every few hours. It just might decide that you're its mother. Oh my goodness, I don't think I'm tall enough to be a giraffe's mother. Or you can feed this manatee with a bottle. A hurricane separated this baby manatee from its mother. Manatees are mammals and their young drink milk. You'll be feeding it by hand for the next year or so. Oh my goodness. That is a lot of feeding for this baby. What's this a picture of? Why are all those people standing on a scale and holding a giant snake? What do you think they're doing? You can pick up a python. Keeping track of an animal's weight is a way to make sure it's getting enough food. But to weigh a 350-pound snake, you'll need to recruit some friends. It's not like you can get the snake to sit on the scale, so you have to get the people on the scale and then hold the snake. You can entice an elephant seal. How do you weigh an elephant seal? This enormous animal is happy to flop onto a scale as long as you reward it with lots of yummy raw fish. And it's only going to add a couple ounces to the weight of the elephant seal. Let's see, who else do we have in here? You could introduce a friend. Cheetah cubs usually have several brothers and sisters, but this cheetah was born alone and it seems to be lonely. Try introducing it to a playmate, a golden retriever puppy. I've seen that actually is a true story. About a puppy who's friends with a cheetah. And that's the end of the story. And here we have a zoo timeline that tells you about how zoos have changed over time. From keeping the animals in very small cages so that people can see them up close, to putting them in much more natural and comfortable environments for the animal. And how zoos can help with conservation, that means making sure that an animal doesn't go extinct. And there's a lot of information on the back pages here about all the animals in this book. So that was a really nice one, I like that a lot. Now it's time for one of our favorites. In fact, Miss Alyssa and I have given this one a star, which means it's on our 100 books before kindergarten. Poster. It's called A Sick Day for Amos McGee. It's written by Philip Seasted and illustrated by Aaron Easted. So they are a husband and wife team that does wonderful stories, and this one is a Caldecott Award winner, so that means it's the best picture book that came out this year it was published. And this one is published by Neil Porter Books. A Sick Day for Amos McGee. And there you see a cozy house and a balloon floating over it. What's going on? And there's Amos McGee. Amos McGee was an early riser. Every morning when the alarm clock clanged, he swung his legs out of bed and swapped his pajamas for a fresh pressed uniform. What's his uniform? He would wind his watch and set a pot of water to boil, saying to the sugar bowl, "Spoonful for my oatmeal, please, and two for my teacup." Belly full and ready for the workday, he'd amble out the door. Every day, Amos waited for the number 5 bus. "Next stop, City Zoo," the bus driver would call. "6 a.m., right on time," he'd reply. Amos had a lot to do at the zoo, but he always made time to visit his good friends. This is the zookeeper in this story. He would play chess with the elephant, who thought and thought before making a move. He would run races with the tortoise, who never lost. Tortoise is pretty speedy. He would sit quietly with the penguin, who was very shy. And he lent a handkerchief to the rhinoceros, who always had a runny nose. And at sunset, he would read stories to the owl, who was afraid of the dark. One day, Amos awoke with the sniffles and the sneezes and the chills. He swung his achy legs out of bed, curled them back again, and said, "Ugh, I don't think I'm going to work today." Oh no, what's gonna happen? Meanwhile, at the zoo, the animals waited for their friend. The elephant arranged his pawns and polished his castles. The tortoise stretched his legs and limbered up. The penguin sat patiently all by himself. The rhinoceros worried that his allergies were worsening. The owl perched atop a stack of tall storybooks and scratched his head with concern. "Where is Amos?" the animals wondered.
Where is he?
It's a city zoo. Later that day, are the animals walking out of the zoo? Oh my goodness, they are. And what are they doing here? What are they waiting for? What's floating down into the penguin's hand? They're riding the bus, the number 5 bus. Remember, if it goes from Amos's house to the zoo, it must go from the zoo to Amos's house. That's how bus routes work. Hooray, my good friends are here. Oh, look, Amos sick in bed, and his friends are there with a red balloon and lots of good cheer. Let's see. The elephant prepared a game of chess. Amos thought and thought before making a move. I'm too tired to run races today, said Amos to the tortoise. Let's play hide and seek instead. The tortoise hid inside his shell. Amos hid behind beneath the covers. Amos yawned. Oh, I could use a nap. The penguin sat quietly, keeping Amos's feet warm. I love how the penguin wears socks to keep his own feet warm. Achoo! Amos awoke with a sneeze. The rhinoceros was ready with a handkerchief. Aww. Very nice friends. I'm beginning to feel much better. Thank you, said Amos to his friends. He swung his legs out of bed. Perhaps we'll share a pot of tea. There they are, and the tortoise is carrying the teacups on his back. Amos wound his alarm clock. It's getting late, he said. After all, we have a morning bus to catch. So Amos said goodnight to the elephant, and goodnight to the tortoise, and goodnight to the penguin, and goodnight to the rhinoceros, and goodnight to the owl, who, knowing Amos, was afraid of the dark, read a story aloud before turning out the light. Oh, so Amos is also afraid of the dark. Maybe the owl really isn't. Maybe he just listens to Amos because Amos is afraid of the dark. Who knows? And there they are, watching the moon and sleeping and getting ready for another big day at the zoo tomorrow. And that's the end of that story. It's one of our favorites at the library. I hope you liked it too. Oh, here they are. Oh, you know what? On the back cover. There they are, returning to the city zoo. So the story is complete on the back cover. On our storyboard today, we are going to be doing a story that comes from a really fun Lift a Flap book called Dear Zoo. And we're going to do it here on the board instead and see if you can try to guess what some of these animals are going to be. Oops, don't peek. One just fell. Hold on. I'm going to fix that. Okay. Dear zoo. Okay. I wrote to the zoo and asked them for a pet. They sent me a, what do you think this animal is? It says fragile on the box. What do you think it is? They sent me a giraffe, but he was too tall. So I sent him back. They sent me a, this one says very heavy. What animal do you think is in there? They sent me an elephant, but she was too big. So I sent her back. Next, they sent me, this says danger. What do you think that is? They sent me a lion, but he was too fierce. So I sent him back. Next, they sent me a, what's this one? This one's harder to guess. Let me see if I move this window over a little bit. Can you see? Can you figure out what this is? What kind of animal is this? They sent me a camel, but she was too grumpy. So I sent her back. They can be kind of grumpy. Next, they sent me a, do you know what's in this basket? But it was too scary. So I sent him back. Next, they sent me a, who's this that likes bananas? They sent me a monkey. But she was too naughty. So I sent her. Are any of these animals yet a good animal for a pet? Not really, but how about this one? What does this one look like? They sent me a ribbit, ribbit. A frog, but he was too jumpy. Whoops, jumped right off the board. So I sent him back. Then they sent me a, what do you think this one is? A dog. And she was just right. So I kept her. That makes a lot more sense. A dog for a pet, don't you think? And that was called Dear Zoo.
Okay, so in your craft bag for today, you should have an animal cut out, a zoo animal cut out. Everybody's a little different. I think there's some giraffes and tigers and maybe a zebra, so different kinds of animals. And then you should get a cord to be able to hang it from, and there's all different colors of the cord. And then most of you got one of these black scratch sticks, but I ran out and I put in these popsicle sticks and they actually work just as well. So what you're gonna have to do is decide how you want to decorate your animal, whatever it is, and then start using the scratch thing to scratch away the black. So I'm gonna put some eyes here. And you can see it's underneath, it's a rainbow. And then I'm gonna start maybe just do some hair here. If you do use this black one, it's very sharp, so be careful. Not super sharp, it's a little bit sharp, so I'll show you that one works too. Let's see, if you need some nose, some whiskers, mouth. Let's see, let's make a toothy mouth, a toothy mouth. Because mine looks like a lion or a tiger. And as you can see, they both work really well. And it reveals underneath some really cool colors, different colors, depending on where you're scratching. Kind of a rainbow effect under there. Okay, and some kids get super excited and scratch the whole thing off, and that's okay too. It just won't have any features, but it will be really pretty underneath. And then you're going to find a spot to hang it from. I see there's like a little punch bowl here. I'm just going to punch that out and put this cord through it. Tie it in a knot, and you are all set to hang that up wherever you like. Could go on a door handle, could go in the craft closet, wherever you like to hang it. Okay? That's it. I'll see you next week.